You have some idea of what we mean by the nature of mind and how its limitation, its incapacity can be taken to our advantage. So the thing is, we need to focus. But as you said, focusing itself is not something out of our range. It is part of the mind's own nature. Because it cannot do anything else but limit its concentration, its focus. But what we are trying to do is, although it is the mind's nature, we human beings normally don't make use of it. We disperse our thoughts, our energies, our consciousness. And that is why the yoga in India had to come up with some methodology, and a methodology which was different for each part of the body. For the mind it was something, for the vital it was something, for the physical it was something. For the mind what we call the Jnana Yoga, then for the emotions we call it the Bhakti Yoga, and for the physical we had the Hatha Yoga. So you see, it was a wonderful method how this each body or mind or emotions, they can be controlled through a perfect methodology. Like, you know, today when people go to Olympics or they have great matches and we have the football players, cricket players, they become good and great and capable after going through a certain training period. And we say this is a modern scientific method of doing exercises so that we can reach Olympic standards. But so was it a methodology which was scientifically done, tested. And the proof of the guarantee of these methods is that for centuries they have lasted. You call it Hatha Yoga or Pranayama or Raja Yoga or whatever. They have stood the test of time, as it is said. And if you see in detail, they are, if not more, as methodological as any scientific method that has been adapted now. So they are, in Shobhinda's words, if I remember it rightly, they are a well-laid, mechanized road. That means a perfectly mechanized, ordered, strong, time-testing road. So one can safely follow all these methods. But then, of course, one has to be a little cautious, as we will come to it later, as to the intention behind these yogas. What is it that you're looking for? And if that is a bit crooked, you can use these things for a crooked purpose also, just like anything in the world can be used for both good and bad. So people have used these yogas for getting black magic powers. So these are not things that we take into account, because we really want to use these time-tested methods for the benefit of reaching our inner being. So it is in that pursuit that we are trying to learn a few exercises of concentration, of meditation, so that down the line when we practice them, take home and practice them, we can benefit. Yeah, you have some questions?
Yeah. When you said that, for example, they've been misused for black magic and all, so what your intention was, what yoga or what was it tantra that you were referring to?
So you see, these are there all kinds of wrong misuse has been done. So what we would like to do, as I told in the morning, is take home some exercises for concentration as well as for meditation. So in the morning we did one exercise, but as we discussed, it was a different result that came through. But I would like to give you now another exercise, and the idea is the same, that try to observe, let the thoughts come in, and you just observe. You don't have to really keep in memory, this is what I did, this is the idea that came through, because then a different faculty in you starts working, the memory faculty, which I don't want. I want you to be just the present, because just the observer, you don't know. As an observer, I don't know next what's going to happen. I just see now a curtain, a flower, that's it. Next moment somebody is coming across the door, I have no idea. So be as dispassionate as that. So I'll give you myself to a couple of topics. And take your paper pencil, and same way I'll give you 5 minutes, and then we will see where we land up.
We are supposed to look at either one of those topics, or
either one of them. Yeah, I'll give one. I'll give 3 topics. Yeah, you can. But what I would tell you is, just choose one.
Choose one.
Write it on your paper, so you don't waver in your decision, and say, okay, that's the topic I'm taking, and then. Close your eyes, let ideas come, thoughts come, and you be just an observer. Now you must be acting like an observer. Roof tiles, a pebble, wayside white flower, Ganesha. You may have still some attachment with some of them, but try to be just an onlooker. wish, you must take it up, huh? Don't just sit, do the exercise. Yeah, we are here to learn, no? Quickly jot down some major idea that came into your mind. In any order, just any order, but the major ideas that flashed across your mind. Okay, I think first tell the guy to speak up, what should
I? Actually, I have another question again.
The question is, you have to concentrate on any one of the topics. Close your eyes, take up one topic, concentrate, jot down what ideas have come to you. Okay, maybe start.
Yeah, sure. This time, when you said focus on a pebble, you know, I actually didn't sort of look at the qualities of a pebble and things like that. I just tried to focus on a pebble.
The quality?
Yeah, I mean, any qualities or any attributes. I didn't want to do that, you know, like previously when we were talking of flour, what's the texture, color and things like that. I just wanted to focus on it and leave it there. Mm-hmm. So then I had a number of thoughts, which I'll share. It was during lunch, when I wanted to take a short nap, instead of that, I had to spend time scolding one of my team members. So that thought came back and, that how it took up my time and how it's not working to his expectations. You know, that sort of thing. Actually, that was also triggered when... Actually, that was triggered when you told Miresh, you know, not to sit, but to start doing that. So it sort of triggered that off in my mind. Then also, again, for my same team, but a different person, and generally the team, how they are, like in any place, you know, when you're away, so how they will, the mice begin to play when the cat's away or something like that, you know, that sort of an association, that, and the thought of the mice and cat, you know, so not just that the team, you know, being distracted or not focusing on the work, so that was one. Then just a very imaginary village wall, you know, with a path next to it and dirt and filth on that, and a dirty wall, you know, with a, so that sort of thought came from nowhere. You know, these are all thoughts which were not at all associated to the pebble in that sense. Then a walk by a pool with the, you know, flower pot range of beautiful white lilies and a nice lovely pool shaded with a lot of moss and you know, things like that, very calm and peaceful, as if it would be in an ashram, sort of a thing. So that came in. Then the thought of a boy, again these are all imaginary, which I didn't, I mean it wasn't that I've experienced it and a memory bringing it back, but a boy, you know, throwing stones on a or pebbles on a surface of water and seeing them skip and skim, thing like that. Then a woman's smiling face with very smiling eyes, you know, that was another sort of a thought which came in, you know, with a sort of a very naughty sort of a look. So these were the thoughts which came in.
Opposite of Anil. I kept thinking, why were no thoughts coming?
Whatever philosophy, how are they all interconnected? And they are interconnected. And for a second, you know, I switched on to that. And then I was trying to figure out if the Ganesha shrunk on the right or on the left for like a second. But it was not there. I was just, and then that's it. But most of the time was...
No thought business. Yeah. You chose Ganesha, is it?
Yes.
I chose the wayside white flower, I imagine the wall in front of acceptance were all covered in white bougainvilleas with white wild jasmine bushes, and I'm sitting on the bench by the road looking at that, and I just asked, I just kept, I was looking at, I wasn't thinking, there was no thought. And actually a very long time, I thought, you know, maybe it's a personal view. I did have that thought. I've taken a personal view. I better go somewhere else. So I went to Japan. And the lovely green area with the white blossoming tree, the petals on the ground, and I sat there, and I just had the only thought at the end, you called, and it was just before you called, it was just lovely, how lovely, that's all.
I chose Ganesha, that is Panchamukhi Ganesha. And I started reciting Om Namo Ganesha and Namaha the minute that Vigraha came into my mind. And except few seconds here and there, I was continuously chanting and repeating Ganesha.
Still there, that's me.
Still.
I chose pebble. The pebble, the moment I chose the pebble, it was like almost like a rounded prism. It was like four-sided and it was translucent. It was not solid color. I mean, it was passing light through it. And it had a small crack on one of the sides. And I was all wondering like how it got these rounded edges and how it holds the light in it. And in fact, like I was oblivious to, I mean, I did not realize any sound or anything throughout till you said, like, you spoke to somebody, Vinish or somebody. And then I was trying to get back and I started hearing the crow and all these other things. Mm-hmm. And then suddenly the pebble was turning a nice royal purple. And then I did not wait for you to, you know, for me to come out of it. I came out of it on my own, like, you know, the purple was so nice and so rich and all that stuff, like, you know, sorry, I just opened my eyes and I just came out of it myself.
I had chosen wayside white flower. So when I started thinking about it, first of all, I just saw this evaporating flower, the idea of happiness came to me. Then suddenly it just was falling down. So I thought it has become perhaps a sad flower. So happiness and sad, these are the two words that came across my mind. And then suddenly my mind turned and I was just feeling guilty. Am I late today for this session? And that carried me away and just hangover off. That was still the end.
This time I was a little bit concentrated to the last time. I was not able to concentrate on which I thought. So this time I choose Ganesha. When I choose Ganesha, so immediately that first thing that I see that big statue in the multicolor. And after that again it has moved to small statue and different type of statue, different colors. And after that I went to see for Ganesh Visarjan. And after that I have seen one temple and there was one big minar was there. In that minar I was going towards up in very high speed. And I have seen one big elephant, one small elephant in that place.
Today you speak.
Break my silence.
Great.
You break the silence. Good.
Great.
Yeah. I chose Ganesha. My intention is concentration. I was focusing. And as I was focusing, crows were communicating with each other. One talking from here, another received the message and passing on the messages. It went round and round. And again, I went back to Ganesha forcefully. Again, the buzz of activities outside. There is a buzz even now. It has drawn my attention. There was a very mild sound of the call somewhere playing. I was hearing that. Then afterwards, the play of light in the mental arena.
I concentrated on Ganesh. Immediately, the Ganesh temple near my home. Then the Ganesh temple at Pondicherry, stories connected with Ganesha Falgun Gadhavati law popularizing Ganesh Puja, different photographs of Ganesha, and even my study room, Samadhi, because Samadhi Ashram, people giving food to a elephant and Ganesh temple at Pondicherry. Ganesh Puja being being performed in a temple, etc.
By yourself, just your permission. In fact, I was not having any test. Ganesha found. I was not having any thought except Ganesha found this elephant head and the human body. This is Dr. Reddy told me that you have to draw something in it. And that thought came. Automatically, I was getting a lot of thoughts. In religion, Ganesha is supposed to be Lord of destroyer of obstacles. Then immediately I thought of Mother. Then I thought of Manakola Vinayaka temple. And normally people will come to Pondicherry to ashram. Most of them visit Manakola Vinayaka temple. In the childhood, I was born and brought up near ashram. So I used to see a lot of devotees going to the temple. There's a big story connected with it. Miraculous story. I don't know whether I have time to tell that. And there is a song by Saintress Abhaya, which is called the Vinayaka Ragavan. If you chant that, I think it shows the way. There's a statement that if you sincerely and faithfully believe in Vinayaka is Ganesha, sorry. Ganesha and Vinayaka is the same. If you faithfully put all your will and thought Ganesha, the prayer says he will come to you like a mother with the love of a mother heart. He will take in your hand for that morning to reach from the silver mine to the highest state. That song is a very big song. So Lord Ganesha here, you can play him in any form. Suppose if you want richness, you can Lakshmi Ganesha. If you want to be a master in your profession, they say Vittaga Vinayaka. Vittaga Vinayaka means a master in your profession.
All this came to you in
this time?
From this song?
The full song was daily. Go to the Ganesha worship. Now, if you go to any temple in Tamil Nadu, to have your prayers straightforward without any obstacles, to reach very gracefully your stage, I think any temple in Tamil you have to first worship Lord Ganesha. So many thoughts came.
I chose a pebble and I looked at it from an aesthetic angle. Perhaps because I had seen something on the computer or somewhere, but this pebble, I was observing the texture and all that because I didn't know what it means to observe, perhaps, so previously I couldn't do. But when you told that we should observe only the object taken, so I examined its texture, which was rough. Its color was light gray. It had a shadow below it, and there was sometimes it was accompanied by a yellow flower, one single flower, sometimes by a white single flower, which would be similar to the wayside white flower, which I thought of. And then my mind did waver to all the three, the roof tiles and pebble, wayside flower, all that. But I could see that it was moving away, the thought was moving away from the pebble, which I had to draw in again. And then it became a pile of pebbles, a roadway of pebbles, a heap of pebbles, all that. But then I again recollected it was supposed to be one pebble. At one point of time when there was a distraction of some noises around, I had lost that track, but then that pebble became as if almost a japa. So I kept on saying pebble, pebble, but I could not see it. So I think that is, when I was not seeing it, that pebbles were kept on ringing in my head. Otherwise, I was very much observant of the noises around. I heard them, but this pebble was equally going on in my head.
There's a second slide there.
Ganesha is in a Pondicherry temple, and then I came to near your window, I said, and then at the same time I got a picture of Lal Bagh Raja and surrounding all the cars and other people are watching. Yes.
So I choose the wayside white flower. When the flower suddenly I got this white rose there. Then white rose came, the mother word came to me, be like a flower. Then I'm only seeing the mother's darshans. She used to give the flower the darshan days. Then the 5 minutes only, I just say all the what I saw videos, the mother darshan, she used to give the flowers and each flower is different. That's all.
Now that you have all spoken what you have seen, heard, imagined, I'd like you to analyze your talk by this. Was it due to a drift? Is it there were some of you have seen, you have followed the single idea. But in some, as you saw, there was different idea that came. There was what we call the drift. Drift. Now, what is the cause of the drift? That's where I would like you to see yourself. I want to tell you. Was it direct association standing around the cat? What, cat means your own subject. Was it due to the intrusion into the mind of a bodily discomfort? Disturbed breathing, sense reception through hearing, sight, etc. Because many of you said you heard the sounds. Or was it due to a thought of the failure in your experiment? Sometimes, you know, when you say there's an anxiety, somebody saying, you know, I got hurt or hurt pride or anger. So just check which one of these reasons or causes applies to your own drift of thought. Just go back into your notes and say, yes, suddenly this idea came, why? So now I want you to concentrate on the why of the drift of the idea. Some of you, like he has this Ganesha, there's no drift. You have seen, it was a continuous thought. But some of you, what was yours was, started with pebble.
It started with pebble.
But you see, you jumped on from pebble to your factory to my mirage to. So there was a kind of a jumping around.
Absolutely.
And you said, are there a thought? So what was the cause behind this no thought, this drifting, this Ganesha, your pebble? There must be one of these reasons given there or something else. You may say, no, my drift of idea came because of this. So I want you to analyze yourself. Later I'll tell you, but can you find any of these reasons given there? Or is there something that you would like to tell yourself? Is it direct association standing around the cat, around the pebble or around Ganesha? What was the cause? I'm trying to tell you. Why did you jump with that idea? Sometimes, you know, you're not feeling comfortable, as I said. Suddenly you change your position and then the whole idea changed. So that could be physical discomfort, emotional discomfort, or a thought that is really disassociated with. Just see, I mean, I'll take a round after that.
Just a question here. Is it is there a hint in your question that for every individual there is a certain reason for the
There is a certain reason why it has happened the way it has happened to you and to you and to you.
Yeah.
One of these reasons applies or something else.
And generally you will have that you'll generally have a tendency for the same reason.
No, I won't generalize it.
Oh,
this time why it happened. No.
Okay.
I would not like to generalize. Just one reason. Because this is again, I'm taking you back to your own thought and analyzing yourself.
True.
So this is again another way of concentration of going back into your clash of ideas. So sometimes there could be anxiety or anger or as Rangaraju says, it could be some kind of a devotion. I would say his devotion to Lord Ganesha. So devotion was the cause of this continuity of thought. Because he as she has not thought of anything else. One after the other, Ganesha here, Ganesha there. So the reason for his continuity of thought is his devotion. Somebody may say, no, I was something else, it was anger, or it was passion, it was anxiety. Or somebody said I came late, so the guilt consciousness. You see, there's some other reason that has brought him the thought. He said, I came late, so I was guilty. And that's what he was caught by. So there is a reason behind devotion, great consciousness, or your association. You see, I have also this direct association standing around the subject. Like in the morning you had the coconut. You have a direct association. So all your thoughts went around that association. So I want you to give me that word, association, intrusion, or bodily discomfort, or thought of failure, or do this, that's it. Try to find a reason, one reason, two reasons. You get that, done it?
Yeah.
You got your reason, yeah?
I think at least for a couple of those thoughts,
mm-hmm.
it was some sort of an anxiety about what's happening back home.
Saw that?
You know, yeah.
So there was anxiety, it led you to the thoughts.
Yeah.
Don't do Good. What about you?
I think if I'm relating my morning and my afternoon, I would go that it's my curiosity, it's me knowing, wanting to know more about the fusion between like what I said.
Mm-hmm.
You know, earlier I was wondering, my thing was Om, and then my thoughts were still, what's the study process here, are there courses here? And now, though I was being able to concentrate, but the only thought that broke my thing was the link between science and,
yeah.
I would call it curiosity.
Yeah.
Maybe it's not written there, but I would call it more
seeking. So it's no, there's no discontent, timidity, worry. So we can add the word curiosity.
I would say curiosity.
Of anything of this kind, yeah? Good. You see, you found your word.
I don't have anything. I continue my thoughts.
Good.
I would say, I think the wondering if you can was sort of why I went to Japan to see if I would have a thought looking at a white wayside scene.
So it was more a wonder.
Well, nothing was happening. I was watching the others, but I thought maybe this is personal and I'll go somewhere else and then
good.
I could have it.
I'm happy, and that's what I want you to find out, yeah?
Except I concentrated on Ganesha.
Yeah, I would put you in the same category as the devotion, you see? So devotion attitude, put it in
the same.
Yeah, it's the same thing, you see? Yeah.
For me, it was due to the need that I had to succeed in this experiment. I did not want it to be a failure. I had to. It's a failure. For me, I put the word success. I want to succeed in this experiment.
Opposite, yeah.
Yes.
So, your
Yeah.
But that want to succeed, can you put one better word?
Due to the thought of
anxiety, worry, the relief pain.
Oh, okay, that pain.
Okay, because you don't want to fail, so there is an anxiety.
Yeah.
After that?
Guilt or anxiety.
Yeah.
For me, it's a direct association.
Is it?
Direct association.
Direct association. You say, I'm happy, see, that's exactly what I want you to do. Under.
Sense perception through hearing. Sense perception.
Sense perception. Oh, very good.
Direct. Association.
Direct association. Yours also direct association. Yours?
Mine are two. One is sense reception through hearing, and one is thoughts came because there was a block in my thought over paper. So I could not think anything. I had to replace it with some other thought. So maybe replacement and sense reception.
Yeah. So you see, we are successful in the sense, each Milesh, I didn't get you. What would be your. Why did your ideas come out of this? Anything?
No, it's flower only I wanted.
Yeah, and yours is more a direct association. Because you see, your thought of the white flower to the mother is all an association. You see, whiteness, and the mother giving white flower. So yours was the direct association. So you see, we do or we can classify these ideas. Now, what am I driving at is, so whenever we feel, now one thing before that I'd like to tell you. Lot of us, or all of you, some did use, some did not. The word, it came to me. And you said nothing came to me. It was a blank. So there is a common word that goes around, that it came. What is that it came? It was a thought. Some of you supplemented with your own imagination. It did come. You see, what I'm driving at is, some of you the idea came. To the others the idea did not come. You direct, those who have had a direct association, you did not let ideas come, but your own subconscious came up. As a formation of an idea associated. But most of you said the idea came. And you said it did not come. You said yes, it was not coming, so I went to Japan for a greater possibility. The truth that I want to tell you is, that is precisely the work of concentration. That when the ideas come, we have to, did not use the word in the morning, you dam them and you open a sluice, a gate. So the idea of concentration is to dam those coming in ideas. First of all, to dam them and to control them, to put them in together. And then open one sluice, one gate. And that one gate that I want you to open is on the topic given. Get it? So first of all, when you close your eyes, you observe things coming. You see, there is a two different things. What Rangaraju did was, or yourself you did was, you started saying Ganesha and your association started. So you did not let ideas come in. You started imagination, you put your imagination running. I did not want that. I want you to really close the mind. In fact, you should choose a topic that is not associated. Maybe I gave a wrong topic. I shouldn't have given Ganesha for the Indians at least. Because most of us are associated with that. If I say the word pepper, I'm surprised nobody chose the word the tie. You chose. No, I'm sorry. Yeah, you chose. But I know. I hope you didn't have direct association.
No. Nothing.
You have such a lovely tile house in your garden.
But nothing connected, like there was nothing.
That's exactly, it's good. So the thing is, I want you to concentrate, because this is only the first exercises later on we'll have. Let thoughts come. Don't pull out thoughts. Because the whole exercise is let them come and then I control. No, not the control. The first word is I observe. So the first exercise of the in the morning and now was to observe. And I have already given you the definition of observation. Observing a thing outside of you. So now you have to put ideas as things outside of your mind. Because that is the truth. That ideas are not born in your grey cells or in your grey hair. They come to you. So once they come, you are a bad host. You say, get lost. I don't invite you to my house. If you are a good host, you say, oh, please come in. I can give you a good cup of tea. So you invite them or you reject them. So that rejection or invitation can happen only when you open the door, you see who is the guy who has come to your door. You see him first. So that is how you have to see the idea. So what I am trying to tell you is, watch your idea. As I said, I started with this and suddenly he went to the company. He didn't go there. The idea of somebody is not doing well in the company, the idea came. He received it. He didn't reject it. This was not the time to reject. We were here just to see who are the guests who have come to my mind as an idea. And this is the very first lesson of concentration, which will subsequently lead us to meditation. But as I said, I'm taking you step by step. So the first thing is learn to observe. Unless and until we become observers, we will not be able to proceed. Because the next step that the mother, Sri Aurobindo, Buddha, everybody says same thing is, the moment you can learn to observe, then you watch them with discrimination. Discrimination means, you see,
dissociation.
Pardon?
Dissociation.
Discrimination is not dissociation.
Differentiation.
What is it that you differentiate? When you differentiate, one idea, one thing is given. So this is given to you. So what is your immediate judgment here? Yes. If I say Sangha, Sangha, take it. So what is your
What do I do with it?
What do you do with it? So immediately she has asked herself, what do I do with this green pen? So should I take it or not? You see, these are the questions that have come to you immediately when I said take this. So similarly, when an idea comes, you observe and then okay, this is an idea like that. Now should I take it or not? Or should I keep it or not? And what is the judgmental criteria or parameter to say yes or no? If I know that Claire is coming to me, I say, oh Claire, it's you, come, welcome. If it is an ex person, I say, I don't know you. I mean, will you be my friend? Should I be my friend? So in the realm of ideas, the whole thing if I apply, I have to see if this idea will help me. Yes, obviously it will help you. But now the question is, in what? In your sense mind? In your physical mind, in your mental mind, in your vital mind, or in your spiritual mind. That means developing which mind of yours or which part of yours. If some ideas come, they excite your vital. You say, no, well, I don't really know. If something comes, no, it is about devotion to Ganesha, devotion to Lord. So yeah, it's a good idea. Because I do want to develop this devotional mind. Come in. So the discrimination is, you get those ideas, invite those ideas which help you in your sadhana, simple word. You see how the psychology is yoga, the simple word concentration is taking us really towards sadhana. Because we said in the morning, if you concentrate well, you can really take it deep here. And we said in the morning, as per the message, we are here to discover that something from yesterday's message. And to discover that something, The path is concentration, the very first step. So coming back to that, so that is the second step is you discriminate. Like the mother would say, be a judge. To judge if these ideas are good or not. Now the third step is to control. You see, you may say that's a good idea, something is a bad idea. But the bad idea, even if you don't welcome it, it intrudes and barges into your house. You say, no, you're not allowed. That's the question of the control. You just bang the door on the face of the idea. That's called the controlling. That's the most difficult one. Because of so many reasons. But that, Sri Aurobindo Mother would say, is the hardest one. Only people like Swami Vivekananda, Sri Aurobindo, Ramana Maharishi, Ramakrishna, these are the top spiritual people who have done it. But for us, the journey stops with
judgment.
With the judgment, the watchfulness. But doesn't matter. If you want to try the third step, you do. I'm not discouraging. But even if I can reach the observation and the watchfulness, that's good enough for me to take another step. Another step not towards control, but the mother has shown us a kind of a detour, a bypass road. The original road was this observation, watchfulness, control and mastery. But mother and Sri Aurobindo, they are given as a bypass road, and then you can skip these two steps of control and mastery and come to the same destination called the psychic being.
Called
right?
Psychic?
Psychic being or psychic person. We'll come to that. So I'm stopping at that, yeah?
Just a question. Here also in this exercise, what we were doing is when we were distracted with the thought, after becoming aware of it, maybe, and there was a sense of discrimination, right? Because we had this exercise, we at this point, it's not relevant.
Mm-hmm.
So there was that discrimination.
Yeah.
And therefore we went back to the pebble. Right? Mm-hmm. So, going back to the pebble was a sort of filling the blank, filling the space with the thought that we wanted to have. And isn't that sort of also equivalent to what they say in Vedanta, for example, that when you create this space, it will always get filled up. So therefore you fill it with, let's say, the divine, the thought of the divine. Is that?
That's the relevant answer, but it's too early for us to.
Okay.
But you're on the right track.
Okay.
You're on the right track. So I'll come into this concentration, these two steps. Now I'd like to take you to the third step, exercise Trilaka. Yeah. Now, you please, all of you, once again, don't take up these topics, but take up an idea, an object, which has nothing to do with you personally. But please, once you read this, I'll put it off, close your eyes, write down your topic and do this. What is it? Do not try to think only of the cat, but deliberately send your thought out along the arrows one another, that arrows is the image that we have, with the instruction to look there and return to the center. That's the essence of the exercise. Okay, let's give an example. Say milk. Cat, mouse, cat, whiskers, cat, claws. You see, every time, as you just now said, you see, you went out, you returned to the pebble. You went out, you returned to the pebble. So, and all the rest of your arrows, bring into vision everything you can think of that has a direct connection with the cat. So, this is a smaller exercise, but I want you to do that. What we did in the morning. So draw this diagram. This is the object. And then you see what are the ideas. I want you to write down these exercises, these ideas, which have brought you back to the cat, to the object. But how many times you went out, came back, went out, came back, went out, came back. This is called, the exercise is called the recall. Okay? Take this up. So make this diagram as I've done on the board.
But we have to name the object.
First name the object, then close your eyes. Give yourself, say, 5 minutes and then fill up those arrows there. That's not required. No, you got the idea, that's okay. Okay, take an object, go out, come back. Okay, and now I'll leave it to yourself. Please change the topic that you...
Sorry, are these topics you're suggesting?
No, not for this. Okay, is ready? So what are the things you jumped out and in?
This time, for me, I noticed, I focused on a garden. Okay, it kept going, I was going, focusing on it. But my garden kept growing.
Kept growing?
Correct, so the greenery, maybe initially when I started, it was, say, it was what I have in Amritsar, a lot of sweet peas, roses. But the green patch, the grass, for me kept growing. And as I kept moving or growing, it went through different territories. It went through like a mountain, but the mountain was not arid. It just kept going with the green. The green patch kept going. So there was no way that I got out of that to come back to it.
You didn't come back to the garden?
Because it kept growing.
Yeah, so you couldn't come back. You kept moving.
Correct.
Yeah.
Excuse me, I think I should say first because I will go make tea.
Yeah. Good. Okay. Thank you for that.
My topic was tea. I don't know how to connect it, but I'm for once happy to say that I could have one strain of thought, tea and nothing else. Huh? And in between what you said, going here and there. First it came the gardens, Assam gardens and wherever I've seen tea gardens, which I really love, those little tree plants like this, such lovely shape, and the color of leaves and everything. Then I think I was thinking about the beautiful weather in those places where tea grows. Or maybe I went at a point of time when the weather was very good. And then those tea ladies plucking, it's so beautiful. Just the tip of the tea thing. And so deft and very beautiful. Then I started thinking about the different kinds of tea, okay? And then I was thinking about my misbehavior when I went for my trip. Everywhere that I went to Europe and America, every house that I went, I said, tea I'm going to make my own. Because I'm so particular about tea and almost it goes to the point of misbehavior. When somebody brings you a tea and you don't like and you don't drink it. So I used to say, I'll make my own tea, please. And I was thinking about that. Then I was thinking of the tea ceremony that was given by mother's friend's daughter to us, Anand and me, in Japan. That is a real ceremony kind of a thing. In Japan, tea ceremony is really a ceremony. So I was thinking about that, which I liked. And then I was thinking suddenly about Claire. Because Claire and I, we were thinking, planning a trip to China recently. We said we must go to China. And I don't know why my mind went to Claire. She's also finding out details on how to go to China.
Tea.
And then I said, China. Chinese people also call it chai. And I don't know what kind of tea I'm going to experience over there. But then it was also, China was also something to do with chai, right? Because when I was in Bangkok, there were many Chinese and they were taking tea and they were all black tea. And then I was thinking of Burmese tea, which was also black tea, and they were taking it the whole day. And then I started thinking, I did a little bit research on Mother and Shravinda's food, and then I said, Mother has said tea and coffee both are poisonous to our health, and I never read anywhere that she took tea. But Shravinda used to take tea. And all Nolinda, Niruddha, everybody, and we Bengalis love to have the proper Darjeeling tea. But Shravinda used to take, but not the mother, I thought about that. And then I was thinking about all of these kinds of grass tea and green tea and flower tea and jasmine tea and leaf tea. And then I was thinking how I love to enjoy a cup of tea, and whenever I take a cup of tea, I really enjoy it, and I like to sit down and do it. I don't like to keep it on the top of the platform of the kitchen and doing some work and taking a sip. I really like to sit down. My first morning tea with my husband is my ceremony. Until he comes down from top after studying, I sit with him and take my tea. That's the first thing I love to do with Anand. So that's my tea. I'm going to make some tea.
Yeah, I hope you have good tea after all this. Tea consciousness.
Anand, but I believe it. I thought only about tea.
Yeah. I'm not a tea lady.
So that means we can also start telling you how choosy we are about tea.
Because I have an anxiety because now tea time is coming. It's 4 o'clock, so I have to make tea. What will I give today? Snacks, puffed rice or biscuit? Or the cups are ready or not? Oh, I'm in the kitchen only. I'm thinking that I'm making some tea. I have to make it now.
So. I just take the object and I just look at it and I try and think only of that and I just leave my mind open. If a thought comes, I note it. Otherwise, if it doesn't come, so fir wo nahi aata. I don't know. That's what I'm doing. I don't know. We are galat kar rahe
hain. Galat to nahi hai. But this is your okay.
That's right. Yeah. So I took the object as chair. Mm. I couldn't think of anything else. So I just kept looking at a chair. And what was the thoughts which would intrude on my looking at a chair is what I have noted. Few.
Okay.
One of them is like running, somehow on me or I don't know who it is, running towards the chair, trying to grab it and sit like how we used to do. Then pain in the legs, pain on our legs. Maybe you want to sit. Maybe it's associated with the chair. And then total rest, that feeling of how when you're wanting to sit in the chair, you sit and then you're totally rested. That and punishment in school, standing on the chair.
Good. You see, you have got really good associations. So why say nothing? In fact, you have got the best one to know. Associations.
For me, I chose the sea as the object, and what happened was that I kept on imagining different sort of situations and conditions and things which I'll just explain. And during the entire exercise, there was only one thought which was all of a sudden, which was totally unrelated to the sea. But otherwise, there were a lot of these, I was a sea in a stock, a sea storm, and then coming back to the proper word of sea, a very calm, placid sea, waves in the sea, different types, sunrise with the sea, sunset and the colors and the changing. So aquarium, scuba diving, swimming, shipwreck, beach, sunbathing, swimming, so all these sort of things. So this entire time which I had, it was in a certain way perhaps because it was a sort of a focus exercise trying to already in the mind, so that germ was already there that you need to come back very quickly. So you could also go out into all the directions.
Should you come back?
Each time.
That's what I want to do.
I choose rose.
Rose.
Which is the symbolism of the sun. I get to again in Dara, my Sierra, and come back and try to remain in the presence of the sacred nations.
Yeah.
I chose the bullet cart, and I missed the bullet cart. And so I didn't write to all that because there were just so many relations, but the bullet cart and the see the driver and the bullet cart and you see the bullets and the bullet cart, you see their painted horns and the bullet cart and the long roads and the bullet cart and the wooden wheels and the bullet cart and the long journey and the bullet cart and the lacking children and the bullet cart replaced by cars.
You have all this coming back, going up and down.
Yeah.
You see, I'm giving you particularly my specific exercise. Don't think that I'm repeating the exercise, but some of you are repeating. You are not catching the central exercise. This exercise was typically going back and forth, not going with the flow of tea or with the flow of this thing, chalo chalte ja raha. It's not a chal. Each time I get a thought, idea of what you said, a stormy sea, then I come back to the normal sea. Then I see the waves of the sea, the big wave, then I get the thought. You see, this is a mental exercise as we do in the gymnasium, your dumbbells and rackets and all that. Otherwise somebody will say you are all doing the body exercise. It's not the body exercise. Somewhere I am developing this, somewhere I am developing this. So these are different exercises, developing different kinds of concentration and control. You see, now when I say, come back. So when you say, I have seen a stormy sea, fine. Then Pondicherry sea. There is a blue sea or the blue of Mediterranean, then a Pondicherry sea. You see, this is, I am trying to control, not to let myself go too far. Only one area I am missing, I am ready to go forward. And then immediately I come to Pondicherry sea. Then if I see the Pacific Ocean, a ship drowning, come back to Pondicherry. You see, in the beginning I gave exercise where you went on, drifting. Then I said, what is the cause of the drifting? Then you are saying now, you go step out, come back. So this is exactly like the exercises that you do. You don't keep on doing like that. You have to come back and then do it. Come back. So you develop this much. So this thought exercise is beside this. So try to understand, why am I giving you this exercise? If you don't understand, you'll be on, you know, along the idea. So try, if you don't understand, tell me, ask me, what is exactly that you want to say?
Sir, what is this, sir? Four roots of thought?
No, I didn't tell you all that as something. That's why I said just one sentence there. Do not try to think only of that, but deliberately send out your thought along the arrows, one after another, with the instruction to look there and return to the center. My exercise was there. Return to the center. Yeah, you are correct.
Then, but I
go through.
You could do. Slowly, slowly. I see that you have succeeded.
I chose music. I sing any other languages. Not connected with any world. So if I sang the song again, I have to go back. This is not my element, so I have to go back and specific to do it. If I choose a different dance, immediately something says, oh, this is not for me. So I have to
go back.
मैं समय ट्रेन से बैठ के पुना गई हूँ और पूरे में दो और बेटे को बता रही हूँ कि यहाँ का मास्टर बहुत ही बड़ा है, आप आइए अब इसका अनुभव लीजिए, ऐसा बोलते रहते फिर मैं अब वापस आ गई
बताने में
So I feel that the move from Chennai to here, and again after that I thought that if I come to train, how it will be. And after that, next time again I thought that if one of my friends will come, then how it will come. And then after that, one thought came that he is fighting with me again. And some other thought also came like after next
milk.
So, and at the very instance its color came to me, white. So again trying to come back to milk. Then I run in other direction. Oh, it is Gurudana, that word came to me. Then after that again and again, exactly opposite. Nowadays we get adulterated milk and so on again I try to see more milk only. But again it clung and it went other way. And see that sadhus require very little food. Why it is so, why it must be so like that? I was thinking, again try to come back.
You're done.
I chose crow. Very suspicious. It unites when there is food to share. It mourns when any crow is dead. It is very intelligent. Mm. At the same time it is foolish also. It allows other world to come and lay eggs and it will hatch. I have a psychic connection with that. I had that experience. People don't know. It produces more than about 20 different notes. Really beautiful. Very nice to hear. Even our parrots don't produce so much. I had that experience. Then, when it gets any disability, I have seen it in a village. Its wing was broken. It is so scared of people, it doesn't go near people. But in that village, it was like a dog going between people's legs and eating food. So adaptable. That has attacked me. And it's a good hunter. I have observed it. When one drives the squirrel from this side, another one comes to catch it. I have seen the play. And it was a very playful creature. It teases animals. It comes, I have seen even in the dogs, it has no business to tease the dog. Dog is scared of it. It comes, it just brushes it like that and goes. And it also teased a cat on the tree. And I observed it, I am not going into the adaptable, I can tell you. Then it hides the food like human hides the food in the crevices. Ultimately, I realized it is a scavenger of the divine, which has sent in the nature. Had there not been any crow, there would have been very interesting all over every magazine part of it.
I wanted to concentrate on Harihar, but in Harihar, Brahmaputra became the central point. Then going to the bridge of Harihar,
then the Guwahati city, coming back to the river drop. Then the Ghatet, because the Haridwar, then Ghatet, Varanasi, etc.
But you come back?
Yes, again to the central.
When I'm attending these classes, I got of teachers teaching. Then they turned up from teachers to leaders, and leaders to masters. And I thought that these leaders are made of form. Like their thoughts are coming. What is the difference between them? So corporate leaders, spiritual leaders.
Leaders, okay.
Like that too.
Right. What is your
First, I had chosen poetry. And I started thinking daffodils somewhere because you had given a flower example, so I had daffodils in my mind. I thought of Wordsworth, but then I thought it's becoming a train of thought. So I cancelled poetry and then I came back to my bicycle, which I had bought. Like. So then I thought of the exercise bicycle. I mean, I kept on coming back and forth, the colour of my bicycle, all the associations, but I kept that figure of bicycle in the centre. But the only difficulty I found was I was in a hurry to rush back. So that was very funny. I could not enjoy that association with the cycle. I really wanted to rush back.
You know, I had this problem. I did not tell it to you. But, I wanted to come back to this because this was supposed to be the focus point and I should not go, beyond that.
Well, it's fine, but if I let you to enjoy that point, what would have happened?
I lost this. This would have just gone somewhere.
So the purpose is not that. You would have enjoyed. But you would have gone off the track and I don't know where you landed, in Amarnath or China. Because the Chinese are on the bike.
You would have enjoyed.
You see, the whole point is that I don't want you to get locked in the idea.
Yeah? Well, I realized after I finished writing this that, I did it backwards. I did bullet cart and went out from the bullet cart and back, where it was just supposed to be the bullet cart driver and then back to the bullet cart. And I'm wondering, it was sort of okay, but I reversed it. Because, do you know what I mean? Every time here you say, cat second, cat second, cat second, plus cat, I was doing
No, it's okay.
It's okay.
Whichever way you're done, is accepted. Do we have to break now? Or what is your position? Go and see.
I just say one more thing. See, and what happened is that when I moved, it's not tasty. Immediately this tea came, taste came, food came, and it was like an extension of my road one. And it was difficult for me to come back to this.
Did you
bring
yourself
back?
Too much
of effort
it was. But you're good.
This quote I mentioned, I was on the track or just...
Yeah, that's what I wanted to ask you all the question. This gentleman's crow, how was it? Was it the right exercise of it? What kind of an exercise was it?
I think this was what we did in the morning.
What you did in the morning?
This was not recall.
It was not on. It was not a recall.
Association.
You have not come back. You see, what I'm stressing here, they wanted to enjoy the seashore and all that. But you have to come back to the... You have given ideas associated with the crew, its friendship. You have given the characteristics one after the other. It could be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. It's not 1, 0, 2, 0, 3, 0, 4, 0. I want this. It is 0, 1. And then 1 to 0 again. Again 0, 2. 2 to 0 again. It's not 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Right. So you see, it's good. I want you to understand the difference that I'm trying to get. Yeah.
Well, I was just thinking when he was telling it, maybe you were assuming pro, you're saying pro and then you're explaining this, and pro and then you're explaining this, but you didn't say pro each time.
He's himself saying, he has gone giving us the characteristics of the pro. It is useful, it is unitarian, it has suffering. So it is going forward. I don't see the backward movement of coming to the square one.
But I don't know if he didn't do that.
No, I don't have to tell every time. I felt.
Oh, yeah.
I don't have to tell every time.
crow, again you go there.
I have not understood
still. No, it is not that. You were going on the exercise one. This exercise was a recall. You have been called back to square one. Right? So this is the thing. We have seen the tea is still boiling, so we are trying. This is the last exercise before we take up the next topic. This is a very interesting one, but please understand. Don't make a mistake in this. If you don't understand, ask me once again. You see, I have given you here four dots called tranquility, flower, circle, yellow. Four random dots. Now you try to interconnect two. But give a sentence, you say flower, circle. Don't just say the flower is circle. You know that. You must make a sentence, an understandable sentence, connecting two, any two, and then connecting any three, and last connecting all the four. So you see, you have got to really focus yourself and say, yeah, get it?
Okay, this is one sentence sort of saying it all.
No, I want four sentences. One, two ideas.
So you just want four sentences, not 20 sentences.
No, only two. One is two, connecting two ideas. Sentence two is connecting three ideas.
Any two.
And then sentence three, connecting all the four. So you have to write three sentences. Three, two, three, four. But making, of course, you know, English is English, you have to make it. Don't just pronounce flower is yellow. That's not a sentence I'll take. You have to really give a good characteristic to flower.
But any two, right?
To begin with, sentence one is any two. Sentence two is any three. Sentence three is all the four. Okay, Mirash, I think you sent me the first one.
Yellow flowers.
Yellow flower. That's kindergarten sentence, not allowed.
What's not?
Yellow flower.
Yellow flower, circle. Yellow flower, circle.
Yellow flower?
Circle.
Not too good. You have put them together.
Add the word or
not? Yes, of course you have to add it, not just this.
Yeah. Right?
Yeah.
I don't know, put in a little bit of imagination here. It seemed to him that she lived her life in her self-created circle of tranquility.
Good.
Sorry, say that again.
It seemed to him that she lived her life in her self-created circle of tranquility.
Maybe, I think others are not able to hear you. Yeah, listen to the sentence.
It seemed to him that she lived her life in her self-created circle of tranquility.
Good, one sentence. Right,
the second. They created a circle of yellow flowers, the marigolds, for the marriage mandapam.
Good, that's a full sentence. You see, how you have made a full sentence?
So that's the third. And the third, to develop calmness and tranquility, they were asked to walk on the yellow circle, slowly placing the yellow flowers on the ground.
Okay, so you have connected all the four, right?
First sentence, yellow represents mental tranquility.
Good.
Sorry, say that again.
Yellow color represents mental tranquility. Second, yellow flower, colored flower helps, yellow colored flower helps maintain tranquility.
Good.
Keep circle in mind. Yellow flower for tranquility.
That's not all that strong.
We chose yellow rose flowers. We formed a circle holding our yellow rose flower. We sat in tranquility meditating on our yellow rose flower.
Did you put put all the four together, nonsense.
Yeah, the last sentence. We sat in tranquility, meditating on our yellow rose flower. Oh, our circle. We sat in our circle. Oh, pooey.
I passed the ball. Oh, I forgot my circle.
Yellow is a divine color, and turmeric, then flower, yellow flower, then second one, flower, yellow rose, beautiful, and it's offered to God.
Yellow rose, beautiful, offered to God. There's no second word in that.
Yes.
Yellow alone is there.
One yellow circle with a bright spot in the center. Suddenly, there are yellow circles. Suddenly, the yellow circles slowly start to expand and become yellow flowers. And the stretches and stretches of them, you know, I have not included all the four words in my fourth sentence.
So
I couldn't do all four.
Flower garden with circular pattern looks good. One can get tranquility of mind when one walks into the flower garden and if restrict their friend circle to saintly people.
Friend circle to
saintly
people.
Saintly people.
Yeah, not done all the four yet.
All four I couldn't do.
Say the other thing.
Yeah.
All four
I
okay,
Jitnak,
yeah.
Near the tranquility circle, a yellow rose woman holding a flower.
Once again?
Near the tranquility circle, a yellow rose woman holding a flower.
Okay.
Yellow flower shown near the circle. I like yellow flower.
Nice.
First is very simple, of course. Many flowers are yellow in color. The second one is yellow color symbolizes bhakti, which finally culminates into tranquility.
Excellent. That's all better.
Yellow flower dominates in the flower box. Arrange first the yellow flowers in a circle as in mother's symbol. Among many colored floral arrangements, I like the yellow flower rimming on the various sides of circle that brought tranquility to the seer.
I have seen a flower within the circle. Second sentence. The circle is made up of yellow flowers. And the number three, yellow flowers within the circle is giving me a sense of tranquility.
First, during tranquility, I experienced cold and yellow color. I experience flower blossoming in a circle during tranquility. Inside golden yellow color, a flower blossoms when I experience tranquility.
Okay.
Daffodils was a poem written by Birthwell in a vision of flowers which he recollected in tranquility.
That
brings
flower and tranquility together.
Yeah,
sorry, say that sentence again.
Yeah, that's from Wordsworth.
Daffodils was a poem written by William Wordsworth, which was a vision of flowers which he recollected in tranquility.
Yeah.
Good. Then I found a yellow bamboo having perfect circles engraved on it. Mm-hmm. I live in the apartment called Tranquility, surrounded by flowers and having fountain of the Olympic circles. Arranging yellow flowers in a corner, in a circle,
or an aesthetic formation gives me a lot of tranquility.
I think this exercise most of you understood, except one or two kuntra, do the four combinations.
She's the first.
No, she has said that.
He wanted to do this.
So you see, this is, yeah, come.
See, once the tea is ready, it becomes cold.
No, wait, wait, we are just coming. We are ready to make it cold.
No, you should know also your timing.
No, we are timing. We asked you, you said 5 minutes more.
No, I didn't hear that.
So you see, basically, this was connecting the dots. So, okay, this is not an English sentence, an English exercise. You have to focus and see the disconnected ideas, you know, like you said, circle and tranquility. They are disconnected apparently. Of course, you have to bring the connections. So that was the connecting the dots. Okay? So we have done, because normally the mention of concentration, we straight away, you know, sit down and close our eyes and we think there's only one way. But as I said, we need to train ourselves even to concentrate. And these exercises that we are doing and we'll be doing for tomorrow also are different ways of concentrating, because as I was giving the example, if you go to the gym, you have different ways of exercising for the thighs, for the stomach, for the back. And all this builds a healthy body. So these are not exercises just for the heck of it. They are all different, connecting the dots or recalling, or we'll see many other types, going to the train of thoughts. So if you give this flexibility of exercises to your concentration, you will have now the control over concentration. When you say, okay, I want to now concentrate. Is this concentrating on a topic? Or if I say, no, I want to really, I mean, you are concentrating and suddenly you are called for tea, and then you say, okay, you go out and come back immediately. See, even at home, even if suddenly there's a telephone call and you are distracted from your concentration, you come back. So these are exercises that can be put in real life also. So they'll be useful. And and the question is, now one of the biggest factors which the traditional yoga does mention, I should not say it does not, but many of the yogas do not emphasize upon two things. And that's something that I would like you to really understand and remember, that concentration and meditation are not done in isolation. That's one of the things that most of the meditation schools forget, and especially those who go abroad to the West, they hardly mention about this, that there are prerequisites, if I can use the word, to be able to do concentration and meditation. You cannot just walk in and say, I'm meditating from 8 to 9 in the morning or whatever the time. You see, this meditation, beginning with concentration, ending up with meditation, is ultimately a way of life. It's not like going to the gym 6 to 7 and then because you're paid and then you go and do the exercise and come. You see, there also, the gym master would say, warm up a little bit, you cannot just start on the treadmill, you have to do some flexing exercises and then you do the exercise. And then you come back home, you dress up and then you go to your office. But then what has happened? That 1 hour exercise, you have warmed up your body, your body is flexible, is energetic, and that energy is carried over to your office. You see? It's not just, it is, you are left at that gym after 1.5 hours. You have gained this activation, whatever you call, the doctors may explain it in any way, But for me what is interesting is you have activated your body dynamo and there is a tremendous energy now on the physical level which spreads over the rest of the day and you see the effect of that energy when you go to the office, when you go to the, your club or your meetings or anywhere, the body becomes a solid support. But the other way, if you have been tamasic, if you have not done your exercises, if you have been oversleeping, you have been lazy, the same consciousness spills over your office also. As she was mentioning just now, sometimes I go lazy, sometimes... And then this spilling over is also dangerously spilling over in the sense it may spill over into some kind of a vital movement. I mean, it may encourage you or it may impel you, it may really tip you over into getting angry with your workers or with your co-workers. Because you are lazy and somebody says, yeah, sir, I have to do this, the three meetings are there. You say, shut up, yeah, get it lost. Because you are lazy. Because the energies are not awakened within you. So when your secretary or your friend says, you have got a meeting at 3 o'clock, you get annoyed. You say, no, why all this nonsense? You see, what I want to tell you is, just as the physical exercises spill over throughout the day, similarly, meditation also is a way of life that ought to spill over the day. Now I'm using the word ought to. Because we think that I have meditated half an hour in the morning and it's over, as she was telling, you get going, you take a bath, dress up, drive and go. But most often that half an hour meditation that you have done is not proper meditation. You have tried to sit, you said 8:30 to 9 I have to sit. You have fulfilled a duty, like we have in some ashram, they say you have to do 4 hours of meditation every day. That is, you know, minimum 10% of the day is 2.5 hours and then another 10% is another 2.5 hours. So these rules of 2.5 hours don't work. And many people, they say, just now as Claire was telling something, you know, there's a pressure here, there's a pressure there. We are not able to meditate. And ultimately you end up sitting there as a lump of a body. But your kind of a moral sense says, tick, I've done my meditation today, eyes over here. But why is it that we are not able to meditate? That I'll deal with when we come to the section of meditation. But what I want to deal with in connection with concentration, which is equally applicable to meditation, is the two prerequisites if you want to concentrate, meditate. One of them is what Sri Aurobindo would call as purified understanding or purification. In simpler words, purification and renunciation. These are the two prerequisites for our practice of wanting to meditate. So please do not think that meditation is an activity independent of what you do in your life. That is why people are not able to meditate, and if they do, it's more or less a kind of a moral sense of duty. But a solid meditation, if you want to do, you have to fulfill these two things, that is purification and renunciation. So today, in the time available to us, I will take up one topic of purification. And of course, in our old yogas, this purification is emphasized. I do not underplay that. But Sri Aurobindo gives it a little different turn. He calls it purification of understanding. You see, there are, I will read out just a couple of sentences. He says, for any spiritual growth, Such an entire rebirth or new birth of the soul must necessarily involve two stages. One of preparation, in which the soul and instruments must become fit, and another of actual illumination and realization in the prepared soul through its fit instruments. Very simple. You have to first of all prepare your instruments. And then once the instruments are prepared, then the stage of realization comes. So all this concentration, etc., is done only when your instruments are prepared. Now, what are these instruments? We have basically the three instruments of mind, life and body. Because remember the word is, he says, one of preparation in which the soul and its instruments. This is something old yogas do not emphasize on. This mind, body, life are not independent, are not the sum and substance of the human being. They are instruments of the soul. So once you understand this, then the whole balance of our understanding changes. Otherwise, I think mind is separate, my emotions are separate, my body is separate, fine. But they're all connected to some master there, who is called the soul. So soul is telling us, look, you three are my instruments. And you must prepare yourself. And one of the preparations it wants is purification. Without purification, no higher energy consciousness can drop into our consciousness. And that's something we miss in our life. Sri Ramakrishna used to say, dudu khavo, tamako khavo. Tamak is what? Beetle leaf. That I will take milk and I will take beetle leaf also. They are two opposite things. Because they cancel each other. So you cannot want to practice meditation and also lead your normal life of sexuality, of lust, of eager food, of all the mirchi food and all the masalas and all the anger and passions on one side. Because you say, well, morning I have done my meditation 8 to 5, 9 to 9:30. Now I can indulge myself in all this stuff of the vital and the rajas. Well, if you are serious, it only says you are not serious. That is why yoga is not everybody's cup of tea. That's why most of us fail in yoga. With all the good intentions, we may have the aspiration, as Swami says, surrender and all that. But please remember, in this triple formula of Sri Aurobindo, the most important thing is the rejection. Aspiration, rejection, surrender. And he puts it in the middle. Please see the position that rejection is given. He doesn't give aspiration, surrender and rejection. He says aspire, fine. That's where the whole flame of aspiration begins. But once the flame begins, what is it you put in the flame? When there's a firewood, what kind of a wood in that? Would you put in that? To get the fire? If you want the flames to come up, you put wood. But what kind of, yeah, somebody said the word?
Dry.
If you put moist wood, flame is gone. So the dry wood and the moist wood is called the rejection. Moist with your passions, moist with your lust, moist with your angers, moist with your jealousies. These are the vital emotions which create that moisture. And then which when you put into your aspiration, it may be you are aspiring, you go to samadhi, you go to meditation, you go to all the temples. God, do me this, Lord, do me this. But what kind of a wood have you put in that fire? Your jealousies, your angers, your wrath, your enmity, your dushmani. And this wood is nothing but which extinguishes the fire of aspiration. So you see, it's a paradoxical situation. I'm leading a life of rajas, want to lead a life of aspiration, spirituality, But you are doing kind of a morning, you do half an hour, and then within the next 5 hours, you have dampened that fire, extinguished it. Next morning again when you get up, you say, oh Lord, I go to Samadhi, half an hour and I sit there and Sama, please Samadhi, Bhakti Dao, Shakti Dao. What's the fun? And they will say, fine boy, you are doing a good aspiration, but let me say after 9 o'clock what you do in the office or in your work area. What kind of enlightenment? So this is what Sri Aurobindo is calling here, the purification of understanding. And he calls this purity feminine and concentration as masculine, passive and active. So remember, purification is feminine and concentration is masculine. And he calls it purification passive, concentration as active. So this is the inseparable connection. So you see the amount of importance he gives to that feminine and masculine. The way Purusha and Prakriti go in life, similar is the relation between purity and concentration. Similar is that intensity of relation, inseparableness of relation, and the way Purusha and Prakriti, feminine and masculine, help each other in their individual and respective growth. So also I must have purity and concentration both going together. That's one. So don't say, oh no, no, I'm having my concentration lessons, purity chalta hai, when I'm 60 I'll do that. No way. So one of the main causes of all our incapacity, failure, to meditate and to enjoy the fruits of the meditation is because our vessel is not purified enough. The divine may say, I will put into you, pour into you the divine honey or the divine milk. But are you the Aadhaar, the right Aadhaar? If you put into unbaked vessel, you may have the best of the milk. But the vessel is unbaked, it is split, it is spilled. So this is one point which we are not realizing, that the vessel, the patra, what we call the patra, you know, the vehicle, the vessel, must be baked. Baked means purified. Purified means burnt, like you have this kiln. You know, there's a burning kiln for the bricks. So that burning is this rejection or is this tapasya. So unless and until we go through the tapasya of the burning of the kiln, the pot is not baked. So no amount of surrender, no amount of aspiration can be helpful, because the mother or the divine says, where will I put my divine grace? You're not able to receive it. There's no receptacle at all. Don't blame me. Fine, you are doing all the Vedic sutras, all the Gita mantras and all the Savitri readings. Fine. You are aspiring, but when I want to descend, where do I come in? You are neither a purified body, you don't have a strong body, you know, it's all the 32 diseases, you go 45 times to Dr. Gayatri with all the ailments. And your moral nerve, vital nature is all punctured, and your mind is not much developed. So the problem the divine tends you back is, you are aspiring, fine. Your ascent is there, but where do I descend? No place, neither mind, nor life, nor body. Yeah, you can go ahead with the question.
Sorry, it was just a clarification. Because when you mentioned two prerequisites, at that stage you had said purification and renunciation, whereas later in the explanation it seems it should be concentration.
No, renunciation is yet to come. For concentration there are two prerequisites, that is purification and renunciation. To be able to concentrate and meditate, two basic things are required, purification and renunciation. I have taken up only the purification, renunciation I will take up later. A comparison between purification and concentration is the feminine and masculine.
Okay.
Later on, I'll take up the equation between concentration and enunciation. I've left it for the present. So, you see, that is the problem. We want to enjoy life as per my definition of enjoyment. The divine is not telling you don't enjoy life. Enjoyment is one of the principles of life itself. Who has told you that you should not enjoy life? But again, the question of discrimination. You have done the observation, watchfulness, discrimination. What kind of an enjoyment is it? An enjoyment that takes me beyond the mind, takes me within me, or an enjoyment that pushes me back in the vital, the external, the sense mind, the physical mind. And they not only are enjoying, you are getting stuck in that enjoyment, because the attraction of this enjoyment is so intense, so colorful, so vivifying, so exciting, that you say, let me enjoy this. The God path is baat ki baat hai. I can take it up later. So the ordinary man is that person who wants to enjoy now and renounce later. You see, what a paradox. But as I told you, there are two prerequisites to go right now, today. If you don't want to do that, fine. I mean, don't come to the seminar, you can get back your money and get going. What I want to tell you is, if you really want to concentrate and meditate, without at least an attempt to do these two prerequisites, it's useless even to think of meditation. You may go to Matsya Mandir 20 times a week, you may stay there 5 hours a day, nothing happens. Even go to Samadhi, stay 10 hours. People make a ritual, I'm a 5 ghanta Samadhi kar baith kar. Kya kya bhai aap? What have you done? I watched those ladies and those men and women wearing different dresses, different fashions, different way of... You have only looked at them. So, but then why do you claim, I've been there at Samadhi for 3 hours? What have you done? Have you looked in or looked out? So you see, we suffer a lot of this moralistic notions, and I'm not very much for that. I mean, with the highest regard for the Samadhi, with the highest regard for Matsya Mandir, if there is no looking within, the spot itself has no value. I mean, it has a spot value, I do not deny that. But as it said, the famous thing, you can take the horse to the river, but you cannot make it drink. Samadhi is there, Matsya Mandir is there, you get a special permission from Sri Moy, 9 to 10 meditation and all that. You're all going to visit on Thursday. But exactly, visit. You're going to visit the Matsya Mandir. Yesterday we visited the mother's room. People say, hey, tumhara room visit ho gaya? Have you finished your room visit? I mean, the real darshan has come out to be only a room visit. And some of you, my friends, have come from Delhi and Calcutta and Bangalore and everywhere. For what? For a room visit? It's not worth it. I'm sorry, I mean, I'm feeling that right sitting in front of the mother and Shwarabandha. A room has its own sthan, has its own vibration. But if I am close to it, what will the divine do? The whole grace I am pouring down on you, you have no vessel, there are nothing in you, no baking done. So I am just repeatedly telling you all that, because to drive home the point that without this question of purification, it is futile. In one word, it's futile. It just, the divine is pouring the energies, and there's a big hole at the bottom of your body, your being. The whole grace is pouring out. And you say, nah, I'm in Shwarabandha Ashram from 1958. Bhaiya, what have you done? What great thing are there? Also, this tree is also there since 1958. So what big about it? My neighbor is there since 1950. So I'm being a bit harsh with myself, in the sense, either throw skaraja and either leave it. I mean, take it up seriously and do it to the hell, go through hell, go through hell finishing. Neither this kind of a pretension of being in, where are you by Shobhinda Ashram? Anand Bhai aate hain Shobhinda Ashram, say, what big has I got, two big horns here? I got only a big, big bald head. So let us not be under the phobia of the place. If you do sadhana, our great rishis have done under the tree, in the cave, in this thing. But yes, when you feel, you know, that there is a sometimes the necessity of either I want to go to samadhi. Now I must go to samadhi. Kyun? Because daily I am going, I must go. Like you go to dining room 7:40, you go to samadhi at 7. You don't have to go there everywhere, every day. But suddenly you feel, oh yeah, I want to go. It may be 8 o'clock at night or 4 o'clock in the morning or 11 o'clock at night. There is a need. Listen to the need. It's not like going to the temple and giving to the god a coconut and a agarbatti. No, spirituality is a need, the inner need. I am explaining this, all this, because I want to apply this to meditation itself. So friends, in integral yoga, meditation is as good or as valuable or without value as you go to dining room. Sorry to say, right in the beginning, I should have said this at the end of it. But what I want to tell you is, meditation is a need of the being. Is not a practice of your mind or your body. When does the need arise? When there is something within says, let me go out, let me get into a different world, let me cut off myself from this noise and noise of this world. So there is a need to go to another world. You want to go to Himalayas, you want to go to Badrinath, you want to go to Kedarnath. Why? Nay, parampara, last 5,000 years said there is Shiva temple there. There is a Shiva temple right here also. So, I am being drastically spiritual. Place, if there is no opening for you, has no value. So, ultimately, where is that Badrinath and Kedarnath and Math Mandir and Samadhi? Right here. So friends, meditation is part of a way of spiritual life. Then only do meditation. Not for the sake of telling a boss, sir, I'm 7 to 8, I'm doing meditation, you know. Yesterday it was 1 hour and then last 3 years I'm doing 2.5 hours and from tomorrow I want to do 3 hours. Mother says, you do nothing for 3 hours. In that 3 hours, how many minutes are there? 180 minutes. In that actually, 178 minutes you sleep. She says only 2 minutes you are in the true definition of meditation. But it's an ego satisfaction by what 3 hours my meditation karam aaj. It's a sham. It is a kind of a hypocrisy, may I say very strongly. Pretension. So right in the beginning, I'm telling you the purpose of meditation is something else. Not just for the practice of it. I'll give you all the practices, but only with this condition that if you can make it as part of your total life. And the totality of life is purification, concentration, meditation and renunciation. So I'll just give you one or two paras from Sri Aurobindo. What does he mean by purification? Of course, if you read the small book, The Mother, read that book. In the very first chapter, he will tell you what is the meaning of rejection. Because some people say, what is there to reject? I'm pretty good. I do my meditation, I go to samadhi, I go to my classes, I go to my work. I don't take any extra money, I'm non-corruptible. But Sri Aurobindo says, have you rejected your preferences? Have you rejected your dogmatic mental ideas? Have you rejected your vital habits? Have you rejected your mental habits? Have you rejected your mental preferences? No. then what is the rejection you have done? And he himself says, people think that they, just because they have turned to mother and show him, and they expect the mother even to reject for you. So sorry boss, our yoga is not one way, because I go to Badrinath and mera paap pura nikal jayenge, you know, I'll be washed of all my papas because I went to that Kailash temple. All that is pushkane ke logon ko le. It has no value. Nobody, no temple, no god can wash your karmas. It's all Brahmin's business. 5000 rupees pocket mein dalte hain, bote your karmas are washed out. Sorry boss, it's you, your karma, your dues, you have done it, you undo. God didn't tell you to do when you did that stupid karma. You did it. So you have to undo. Who can help you? So all that old religiosity of do this puja, that Vishwakarma puja, this, that, have nothing to do with spiritual life. So purification is a thing that has to be done. And we will see later on how Sri Aurobindo comes about with renunciation. That's why these chapters I'm taking from the synthesis of yoga. I mean, when I read that, I'm zapped and really I see, yeah. I mean, it sometimes shows a mirror to you. Where are you in your consciousness? And so one or two paragraphs, I'm just looking at your watch. The first necessity of preparation is the purifying of all the members of our being, especially for the path of knowledge, the purification of the understanding, the key that shall open the door of truth. And a purified understanding is hardly possible without the purification of the other members. What is the meaning of other members? The vital, the physical, the emotional, the subconscious and all. And he says, an unpurified heart, an unpurified sense, an unpurified life confuse the understanding, disturb its data, distort its conclusions, darken its seeing, misapply its knowledge. An unpurified physical system clogs or chokes up its action. Brilliant. Exactly as I was telling you, in that fire of aspiration, if you put this wet wood, moist wood, it clogs the fire, it clogs your aspiration. It not only it extinguishes, first it clogs. It doesn't let the fire go up. It's so much under control and so much under control, and slowly the fire dies out. So he says, there should be, and what is the thing? An unpurified sense, an unpurified life confuse the understanding. You see, we say we are brilliant professors, we are brilliant architects, we are brilliant artists. But when it comes to spirituality, all the brilliance, it has no value. He says, why is it that we don't understand, we cannot guide in the beginning what you said, it controls and I contested, no, it doesn't control. Why is it that the mind doesn't control? Because of this impure vital, impure physical. The physical habits are impure. What is it that is impure? You read the Gita, you will see what are the three kinds of food, the tamasic food, the rajasic food, the sattvic food. And we cherish on that. I have to eat rajasic food and all that. Then these impurities do not let your mind get its strength. They put the chain around the mind. And subsequently, the mind says, okay, Baba Rajas, whatever you say, I will obey. You know, because you have enchained the mind, you have not let it be its own free understanding, greater understanding, receive intuitions. You have not let it happen. In a simple example, you have a pool of water, the surface, you disturb it, does it reflect? The moon reflection on the turbid ocean, you see when there is a full moon, you can hardly see the moon there. Because the ocean is turbid. When that turbid, that full moon goes away, when the ocean becomes smoother, then you have the full moon reflecting. And not one moon, thousands of moons. Because every wave becomes a moon at that time. it's absolutely the same thing. In the turbid ocean of emotions, the divine cannot reflect itself. The mind cannot function. It has, out of this 100%, 10% of our mind works, 90% of the mind is under the control of the emotions. So what Shravana is telling us, unpurified life confuses the understanding. That's what the Gita has said. If you are angry, if you are passionate, if you are lust, it disturbs the mental waves and then you cannot understand. Even your understanding goes. So if you want to read Savitri, if you want to read Lifedivine, if you want to read Synthesis, you say, sir, I don't understand. How will you understand? And why should you understand? How can you understand? If the waves, if the emotional ocean is a tempestuous ocean. So friends, if you want to reach Sri Aurobindo, you have got to do tapasya. It's not a Jackie channel, some novel there, which is part of the emotional being. But here, it's a very high reflection. So you will not understand, not that I understand, don't think I'm saying that I understand, no. It is somebody called Nalini, Kanta Gupta, who understood. Because he did this tapasya. In him, this vital was completely smooth. Not a drop of disturbing ocean. So he would be the Manas Putra of Sri Aurobindo. So you see, these things have a great scriptural value because they demand from you a preparation. You cannot take it at night and say, hey, page number 142 and read and say, yeah, Nidara Rakhya. It's not a sleeping doze. So he says, it doesn't give you understanding, distorts its conclusion, darkens its seeing. I mean, if you have had a very disturbing night, if your stomach is not right, if you haven't had a good sleep, in the morning when you wake up, you see what kind of a vibration you have. You don't understand a thing, your clarity of thought is not there. When you go to the office, you have a wrong judgment and you throw up tantrums at your office people saying, you are not doing well, what is this wrong mistake? But the mistake is yours. Because you have not been in that really the quiet consciousness which reflects the higher knowledge. So that's why the leader, somebody was talking about the leader, he's not just a leader of a company. He has to be leader of his own emotions, his own valuations, his own mind, his own body. You first lead yourself, yaar. What do you think of leading the 32 people in the office? You have no business to lead them. Just because you have been appointed leader of so-and-so company, CEO of so-and-so company, you are given this big fat salary, you think you have a big ego and that I am the leader. But from the yogic point of view, you are not the leader. So Shobhana said, there must be an integral purity, that's the question, that's the line. Integral purity means body, life, mind and the spirit. So ultimately, one more sentence, I can read out. He says, it may even be said that while each member of our being has its own proper principles of purification, yet it is the purified understanding that in man is the most potent cleanser of his turbid and disordered being and most sovereignly imposes their right working on his other members. You see, why is he giving the priority to understanding? That means if I want to have the right understanding, I must have an integral purity. And if I have the right understanding, I will lead my life rightly. How to deal with relations, with my colleagues, with my friends, with my officers, with my dushman, with my society, with Pakistan, with everything, everything. So my whole attitude changes. There's no enmity, there's no Islam, there's no Pakistan, there's no other creed, there's no Brahmin, there's no Kshatriya. That's my understanding, because this understanding, stupid understanding, which is dividing my society now. So if I have a proper understanding, then my whole social relations change, the divine relations change, religious relations change, everything changes. So Sri Aurobindo says, understanding which leads the human being at present is the most important. But for that most important, it must be supported by a purification of the vital, of the physical. And the last sentence, by the understanding we mean that which at once perceives, judges and discriminates the true reason of the human being, not subservient to the senses, to desire or to the blind forces of habit, but working in its own right for mastery and knowledge. So one way, one just sentence that tells us is that the mind should have the proper perception, judgment, discrimination, and it should not be subservient to the sense, to the desire and to habit. So one of the things of what is the meaning of purification of the mind is it should not be subservient to the senses, to desires and to the physical habits. Habits good, bad, you drink, you do that, you do this. These are enjoyable habits. These are compromised habits. These are habits which say, okay, doesn't matter once in a while, kya fara padta. But this is where the purification begins. Of course, there's a long way of purification which Sri Aurobindo explains here in this chapter. Sri Aurobindo given us three main causes of impurity, which I will just mention one by one. The first cause of impurity in the understanding is the intermissions of desire in the thinking functions, and desire itself is an impurity of the will involved in the vital and emotional parts of our being. When the vital and emotional desires interfere with the pure will to know, the thought function becomes subservient to them, pursues ends other than those proper to itself, and its perceptions are clogged and deranged. You see, that's what we started the discussion with. We are the so-called mental beings, we have the mind, intellect and all that. He says, no, we are most subservient to the desires, and these vital and emotional desires interfere. You see, as I said, they interfere with the thought, they interfere with the intuition, they interfere with our reason, and ultimately the reason collapses and it follows only the desires and all that. That's one cause. Of course, he explains more in detail. And the second one is, he says, the second cause of impurity in the understanding is the illusion of the senses and the intermissions of sense mind in the thinking functions. No knowledge can be true knowledge which subjects itself to the senses or uses them otherwise than as first indices whose data have constantly to be corrected and overpassed. This is the second fallacy. First one is the desires. Our mind is such a slave of desire. Second one, if our mind thinks that sense data is the ultimate data, there's again an illusion.
What do you mean sense data?
You see, this is my sense. What is this? It's a glass, it's cold. What is that? That flower is orange. I mean, what a purple color. So this is the data that I get from the senses.
Perception.
Perceived, sense, all the five senses. The five senses, whatever data of knowledge it gives, if my mind thinks that is the ultimate thing, because I've seen you sitting there. But maybe my eyes were wrong. Maybe you're sitting on second seat. So there is a misconception. There is a probability that the senses are wrong. But my materialistic scientific mind says, no. Whatever my senses have given is the right knowledge. That's not true. There is something beyond the senses. There's a second impurity. The third cause of impurity has its source in the understanding itself and consists in an improper action of the will to know. And the third one, because of this impurities, we have a wrong understanding of things. We do not observe rightly, we do not judge rightly, we become, when you are a slave of these things, your judgment becomes wrong. So there's all a mess up. So what I want to tell is, first of all, is the desires, the vital. Second one, the senses. Third one, because of these two desires and senses, your focus itself changes. So you're looking at a person with a different eye. Because you have in that perception added desire and added a sense knowledge, so the lenses change. And because of the change of the lenses, my perception changes, which I think is right. But go back and say, hey, no, wait. When I said that person is like that, what were the things involved? My prejudices, my preferences, my attractions, my relations. So can I be objective? So these are the things. I will not take your time for that, nor do I have much time.
So can we say that it's like a self-improvement? The second stage could be a self-improvement and a self, again, another self-improvement, I would say, a stage where you stop running judgments on what you see. But
yeah.
You analyze.
Now you come back, as you say, if you want to find a solution, yes. First of all, you withdraw from this desire-based judgment. Because when you judge somebody or something or an event, first thing you say, ask yourself, was there any desire involved in my judgment? Any desire of money, of name, of fame, of relation, of getting something? Or has it been a very objective judgment where there's no question of desire and senses coming together? If you see, nay, there's something called personal thing because I wanted to get something out of him by flattering him and all that, then you say this judgment was completely wrong. And so there you have to stop. That it is cannot be a judgment linked with desires. Second one, it should not be a judgment that is completely based on senses. Because never senses are only, like our famous Kena Upanishad tells, so they're only doorways for the light to come in. You see, when I see a glass, who is seeing it? The reflection of light from the glass is coming through my eyes, it falls on my retina, it goes to my brain, and the brain interprets saying that it is a glass. You see, when I put my hand like that, the sense data doesn't go through my hand. It is through the eyes. So the senses are only doorways for the information to go within, to go through the mind, and in the mind to judge. And now that fellow mind to judge, what is happening? He is under desires, he is under sense mind, and he says, no, what you have seen is right, Gauri. He interprets, saying, no, what you have seen is right because I depend on the senses. And then he says, no, no, I think this Sangha is very good because, you know, I had a desire that I went to Mysore, it's a lovely house, so I must have good relation with the Mysore. You see, all this is desire linked. So my judgment of Sangha is partially colored because of my personal desire. So my objective is saying, no, Sangha is not, nothing to do with my good or bad. But any opinion is colored by my desire. So can I be away from that? Because you may say, in every instance it's difficult. But in some instances, if you start practicing, as you're saying, self-improvement. Improvement where? Non-desire based, non-sense based. Of course, you should not be that foolish also to say, no, this is not a glass, you know, it can be something else, a statue. I mean, let's not be foolish also to go to that extent. But any data, especially when it comes to human beings, it goes so much up by human sense data. No, she did not smile at me, no, she smiled at me. Immediately I make an image and say, oh my God, something is happening, she smiled at me. Just because of the sense data. So these are things that Swami is telling us. These are the impurities by which the mind suffers. So whatever sense data goes within, the mind misinterprets it because it is itself under the load of the senses and the desires. So see, these are the impurities. Of course, if you read the mother, you will see much more the what are the purification to be done. But I will not get into that because tomorrow, when we come, I will have to take up the renunciation and then again some exercises on concentration that would do the flexing or the suppling or the warming up exercise for the meditation. As I was telling of somebody, yeah, for the meditations it will be exercises, but there will be guided meditations, longer meditation, 20 minutes, 30 minutes. And I try to give you different kinds of meditations so that you get a taste of what are the different types of meditations and what is ultimately the meditation type that Madan Sri Aurobindo recommended. What is the advantage here? What is the disadvantage with the tradition? Because, you know, meditation has been part and parcel of our culture. So obviously it has its own important points. So we cannot denounce that. But at the same time, what have the Madan Sri Aurobindo, what have they added into this dimension of meditation? Yeah, so we will close the day. I hope you are not very tense and your exercises have not been too harsh. And so I wish you a good evening. Go and relax on the seashore. And try to look at the waves and concentrate a bit. And you know, one of the things it seems Napoleon used to do was sit on the beach and count the waves. So that was a relaxing exercise for him, you know, one, two. I tried to do that, but I fell asleep, I suppose. So now you can't even see the ocean waves, but do have a walk just across and you come across the sea. We'll have a bit of concentration before we go.